So I'd like to start by looking again at that prayer by Frank Madison Reed III. In a culture filled with divisiveness, he says, disconnectedness and domination, we pause for a moment of centered cosmic Christian connection that will bring wholeness and healing to ourselves and our world. We pause for a moment of connection that will bring wholeness and healing to ourselves and our world. Now, regardless of whether we think of ourselves as Christian or not, there is something to be said for getting centered in the cosmos, for pausing, realizing, and accepting that our wholeness, our survival, depends a great deal on things and entities that are outside of ourselves. For example, some of you may already know this, but I am not a big fan of city driving. Furthermore, I am probably not the best driver. Some of you have driven with me, I think, youth groupers. So you can imagine my anxiety when at one point during the Christmas season, for a variety of reasons that I'm not getting into today because there's not enough time, I found myself in the position of driving my intern Timothy back home to Cambridge at night following one of our recent weather events. Now, of course, I got there just fine because Timothy knows where Timothy lives. And with a few brief directions, they guided me right to the door. But the problem was that then I had to drive home by myself. And what seemed clear to me in the car with Timothy suddenly became quite vague. Now, this is the point in the service where I would normally ask who here has ever gotten lost driving in Cambridge, but I suspect that many of you would be tempted to lie. And I do not want to be guiding anyone to sin this morning. So I will just assume that you know what I'm talking about when I say that I got down to the corner of Timothy Street and I went around at least one traffic circle. I realize in Massachusetts you're supposed to say rotary, but bear with me. I went around one traffic circle at least and then made a couple turns before realizing that somewhere I had gone horribly wrong. And that realization dawned on me because I drove by what might have been Tufts University. And Tufts University is not in Cambridge. There are many colleges in Cambridge. This is not one of them. And it was not in the direction that I wanted to go. So naturally, still thinking I could just figure it out using landmarks, and an innate sense of direction that it turns out I do not have, I drove around a little bit more. But then as time passed, I realized I had a problem. So I pulled out the map function on my phone, found the little blue dot, and then failed to read the map function properly. And I ended up in some quiet, dark neighborhood filled with snowbanks where there was no one to ask for directions. And there, wherever there was, I could not lead you to it. I realized that I was powerless to resolve this situation myself. I was lost. And I was likely to stay lost if my pattern of behavior did not change. So I pulled the car over as much as I could, kind of into a snowbank, so that folks could get around me. It was late enough that I really didn't have to. And then I turned on the voice function on my phone. And it turns out, of course, it's a voice function, not the one you talk to, but this is the satellite voice. It turns out that that voice function is an amazing thing. Because on came a remarkably calm computer voice that proceeded to give me precise and on-time directions and led me out, in a matter of minutes, back to Route 2. Now, each of us has had times when we have been lost in the dark. And part of our human nature when we are in those situations is to believe that we can find our own way out. And sometimes even we convince ourselves that we are not lost. In fact, most of us, most of the time, tend to believe that we are just a little bit more clever than we actually are. That we are, in essence, most likely correct in our assumptions, even if the landmarks, even if the evidence doesn't seem to confirm it. The great explorer Daniel Boone embodied this tendency. He once claimed that he had never been lost, but that he would admit to being very confused for several weeks. Now, many times our struggles are individual ones. Relationship problems, addictions, work issues, math homework. And usually at some point in that process, we individually realize that we need to ask for help. Help from friends and family, help from strangers, help from computer voices on the phone, or help from the divine. And then we start our climb back to the actual right path. However, sometimes the problem we face isn't an individual one, but is in fact a corporate delusion, a group behavior, a cultural norm that we follow, convincing ourselves and each other of its correctness and its rightness. And these cases of societal confusion in a world that Reed describes as being filled with divisiveness, disconnectedness, and domination, these cases of societal confusion can be very hard to overcome because we are all wandering around with great certainty and with little interest in self-correction. Think of the efforts people have gone through to legitimize segregation and then racism in general, or sexism, or homophobia, or any number of forms of bigotry, casual or otherwise. The fact is, we as human beings can be lost together, and in our darkness perpetuate inequalities and injustices. And that's the sort of lostness that John the Baptist berates his followers about in our reading today. "You brood of vipers," he says, "bear fruits worthy of your repentance." But then, when his followers, or at least the ones who did not become offended and leave, when his followers realized their own imperfections and in fact sought to make reparations, John's tone changed. The calm, reassuring Alexa voice came out as he told them, "Whoever has two coats must share with anyone who has none, and whoever has food must do likewise. Collect no more than the amount prescribed to you. Do not extort money from anyone by threats or false accusations." Now, John did baptize his followers. That's the good news. Even though they had made mistakes. As human beings, we get lost in the weeds, but there is still hope for us. The problem is that it sometimes takes a great deal of effort and sacrifice to get us all together back on that path. And John, like many of the heroes of the Bible, is a prophet and teacher, and that's part of his job. To get us back, to be confrontational, to be willing to stand outside of polite society, to speak the truth to people who may not be willing to hear it, to risk and possibly to accept death at the hands of those who ultimately he is trying to help. And this is true today as well. This weekend, we are naturally thinking of Martin Luther King Jr. Yet just as with John and Jesus, the injustices of the world did not stop upon the event of King's death. but sometimes we're tempted to act like it, aren't we? To treat this weekend, for example, as an opportunity maybe for service, or an opportunity more likely to run errands and sleep in, rather than as a chance to reflect on the call for justice that was King's true legacy. Now, we've made a habit of this as human beings, of course. We do the same on Labor Day and Memorial Day and Mother's Day, giving them all a domesticated veneer that enables us to enjoy them without encountering that persistent and nagging feeling that perhaps we are the ones who need to change. Which is why on weekends like these, we are reminded of the words of the Universalist minister Clinton Lee Scott, telling us that always it is easier to pay homage to prophets than to heed the direction of their vision. You see, these days we are still challenged, as we have always been. The direction of the prophet's vision has not changed, and we are called to accept that our assumptions about our place in the world may actually be wrong. To accept that our comforts in the world are in part based on a privileged place in society rather than superiority of effort or ability. Many times today's prophets have hashtags in their names, which can be confusing. Things like Black Lives Matter, Occupy, or Me Too. But the issues these movements point to are still our responsibility as much as anyone else's, even if we don't tweet. Now, unfortunately, it is easy to think we already know the direction and to believe that we are already walking that path. In the journey of faith, it is important to find our own humility. Our challenge is to think like prophets. To think like prophets, even if we do not feel like prophets ourselves. Our challenge is to live lives centered on something greater than ourselves. And whatever that greater thing may be, we must be willing to be accountable to it, to do the hard work. Our faith needs to be something more than that warm, fuzzy feeling we get at Christmas Eve. It must contain a call toward openness, toward inclusion, toward justice and love. This is why the prophets pray. And why we pray too. And we do all pray, at least in a sense, whether we think we do or not. Regardless of our systematic theology, there is the prayer of mindful living. There is a prayer within a song, or a picture, or a sculpture, or a book. And then there is, in fact, conscious intentional prayer or meditation. And the unconscious reaching out of our hearts in times of joy and sorrow. So today we heard a lot of prayers. Three that we may not have heard before. The first one, of course, was the opening words of the Quran, confessing lostness and the need for help. Guide us on the right path, it asks. And then we heard also from Reverend Frank Reed articulating a direction while also asking for support from that which is greater than ourselves. Liberate us, he says. Liberate us from building our kingdoms and liberate us for the kingdom of God. And finally, we heard from Martin Luther King. In this case, celebrating the gifts we have received from the journey, as well as the call that sends us out. We thank thee for thy church, he says, that challenges us to do more than sing and pray, but go out and work as though the very answer to our prayers depended on us. We are lost. And in some sense, we are all lost. Let us remember to live prayerful lives, to be mindful of our own failings, while being grateful and humble about our strengths. Let us remember that we are not alone, that we can reach out to help and to be helped, and that we are, in fact, called to do so, to create a just world, the commonwealth of heaven, built on hope and love for us all. Let us take a moment in silence to think on these things.